And so we watch and wait and stay aware, waiting again for the coming of Jesus, and we light a single candle in preparation for that glorious day.
Jesus comes to us in the song of a choir, in a letter opened in a prison cell, and in the smile or the cry of a child.
And we will light a candle to remember that Jesus is here.
It is for Mary that we light this fourth candle. Glory to God in the highest, and peace among men.
Stay by my creator. Amen, amen. Amen. Here we are, finally. Oh, I'm looking at my kids and I know, and I'm so excited. It's Christmas Eve and we are here to hear the story, to hear the songs, to sing the songs, and to listen to the story told yet again. And so without any further ado, I welcome Rob forward to begin the telling of the scripture, starting with the Gospel of Luke.
Merry Christmas. The first reading is from Luke, book 2, verses 1 through 7. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up to the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David. Because he belonged to the house and line of David, he went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. And she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. Blessed is he.
The third reading, Luke 2:13 through 15. Suddenly, a great company of heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angel had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about."
One of the real joys of this past year has been to welcome a new church start that asked for meeting space here at Aldersgate, the Church of All Nations, led by Pastor Johnson. Many of you have had the chance to meet him and his family and those who worship on Sunday mornings at 11 o'clock in the parlor. They've been a blessing to us in so many ways, including their prayers for our own church, which I know have blessed us. And so I spoke to Pastor Johnson a few weeks ago and said, what are you going to do for Christmas Eve with your new church? This is your first Christmas Eve here. And he said that he would join us and that they would bring us a song. So we're so thankful to have you with us, and we welcome you forward now to share.
One day rule the nations.
Did you know?
treat on Sunday mornings. We finish up in here around 11:30, 11:40, depending, 11:45, and I'll finish worship on Sunday morning and go into the office room to take off my robe, and there is the Church of All Nations just getting started, and that wonderful music pouring out of that parlor this Sunday. So it's such an encouragement. We're so glad to have you with us. Let's spend a few moments in prayer. Lord God, we are distinctly and keenly aware of what a privilege it is to be here on tonight. We are aware of this because we know that our faith is such a gift, that it comes from you, God. And that when we struggle and we feel like we need help, God, that you bring it to us. God, we thank you that everything that you have done in our lives has brought us to this point tonight in big and small ways. God, we're humbled that you love us so much, that you've given us that gift of faith. And more than all these things, God, we celebrate tonight the birth of your Son, Jesus Christ, here among us to walk in our lives, to walk into our lives, God, as a human being, understanding our griefs and our sorrows, and we recognize just what an astonishing thing that is, that you would come here and be with us. We ask that you would help our hearts and minds be aware of this through the power of your Spirit. And now as we consider what the message is for us this evening, God, we ask that you would have our hearts be open to you, that we would release anything that we need to let go to you, that you would forgive us any sin, any burden that we are carrying with us, God, so that we can hear your message fresh, and so that we can walk from here encouraged and enlivened for the things that you are bringing to us next. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Before I get started, I want to make sure, I understand we're going to do a little thingy. Yeah, okay. But I have to share an observation that I saw on Facebook from a pastor friend of mine today, that this evening, Christmas Eve, is actually warmer than the Easter sunrise service was this year. By like 20 degrees, too. We were out at Easter sunrise, absolutely freezing. So Noah, in just a little bit, I'm going to ask for lights so that we can have a video clip. This year served as the 50th anniversary of a very important cultural event. In December of 1965 was the first airing of the Peanuts Charlie Brown's Christmas special. Who here has not seen the Peanuts Christmas special? Anybody? No, you're not going to admit it. They're okay, Noah, you have an assignment for tonight, okay, my friend? With Charlie Brown and Snoopy, 50 years ago that special aired for the first time on CBS. And I guess that it almost didn't happen. The executives at CBS were extremely worried about it for a number of reasons. First of all, Coca-Cola was the one who asked that Charles Schulz develop some sort of half-hour Christmas special to promote their product, right? So it'd be a vehicle for their advertising. And Charles Schulz had gained a lot of popularity by that time as the artist behind the Peanuts cartoons. So he set about to do it, and he did it in his own way. There had been no cartoon Christmas specials up to this point. And so in his own way developed a special. It was behind, it wasn't funded well. I think the entire funding for the project was $95,000. Can you imagine that? It got behind, and he turned it in late, and when he showed it to the network executives, he got a big thumbs down. They really did not like what he had done, because his first mistake, in their opinion, was that instead of using adult character actors who were humorous and cartoonish in the way that they spoke, he chose to use real children in his special. And so people felt that the delivery was boring, that it was flat, because the children weren't polished actors. He also chose as a musician for the soundtrack a jazz piano player. And the effect the adults felt was kind of melancholy. Not to mention that he didn't include a laugh track, which was completely common, if you can remember the Flintstones and the Jetsons, right? There's always that laughter. No laugh track, melancholy music, children's voices. The cartooning was hasty, it was sketchy, it wasn't that polished looking. But more than any of that, this cartoon special was religious. It actually quoted scripture. And they thought, there is no way that this is going to fly. They almost canceled it, but it was so close, within 10 days of the air date, that they felt that they had to go forward. And maybe in spite of all these things, or maybe because of all those things, it has become such a beloved Christmas classic. The night that it aired in the place of Bonanza. So all the people tuning in to see Bonanza instead saw Charlie Brown. And do you know that 45% of the television audience on that evening in December watched that Charlie Brown Christmas special? It has gone on to air every single year. After that, it won an Emmy, it won a Peabody Award, the soundtrack has won awards, and now we're all familiar with it. We like it especially as Christians, because this one gets it right. In the Peanuts Christmas special, it talks about how commercial Christmas has become. And I'm thinking 50 years ago, they were already saying that. How commercial Christmas has become, and what the real meaning of the season is, Jesus' birth. Who tells us that? Who tells the real meaning of Christmas? Do you remember which character it was?
Linus.
Linus is the one who says, I know the reason for the season. Linus is the one who speaks the words from the Gospel of Luke. Linus is the little guy who walks around carrying a security blanket all the time. You remember him? With a little blue blanket under. Yeah. He's the one who seems like the littlest child, and yes, he has the wisest answer of all. In fact, Charles Schulz, who cartoons Charlie Brown, said that Linus, in all of his cartooning, would often be the voice of that adult wondering, that spiritual question, that existential, philosophical question. You'll see those things come out of Linus's perspective. But Linus has to carry that blanket, that security blanket, to feel safe. Do any of you have a blanket at home? Yeah, I know my kids do. Yeah, I still have mine. My mom finished mine when she was in labor with me. And so how do you throw that out? You're not going to throw that out. Right? We have that blanket, and it helps us to feel safe, doesn't it? Helps us to feel like we can go to sleep if we have that blanket with us. What kind of a silly thing is that? I mean, it's a scrap of cloth. And yet it really changes how we feel about things. So Linus and his blanket. I want you to watch that segment of the Charlie Brown Christmas special when Linus tells us what the meaning of Christmas is all about. And this time I want you to watch Linus's blanket. What happened to his blanket? He dropped it. What was he saying when he dropped it? Did you get that?
Fear not.
Fear not. Fear not. I talked to a pastor friend of mine, and we were talking about that particular moment. You know that Charles Schulz is a Christian, right? He's not like a profound spiritual teacher, and he certainly didn't see his cartooning as Christian cartooning, but his Christian faith influenced what he did. And my friend and I, and a couple others who've done some writing about this, agree that this is very deliberate on Charles Schulz's part.
As I rock you come sleeping, angels guard their watch are keeping, precious child one day we shall see, what love is destined for you.
Of all the tasks that I do around Aldersgate, both of them,
This is one of the best that I like to do. I have a couple of special gifts that I'd like to give to two very special persons. First of all, I'm wondering if there's anybody in this congregation whose name begins with Kayo. I'd like to call Kayo Kamau forward. Look at this good-looking young man. This is a dedicated man as well as a talented man. He has talents, languages, I don't even know what they are. He drives all the way from Northboro several times, a month every Sunday to meet us and to help the praise band. And the praise band is as good as Kyle has been able to make it. So, Kyle, thank you very much. Last year, at the same time, what we did was to buy you a piano. It's right over there. This year, we decided that we were going to buy you a brand new automobile. So the committee that I belong to went down to the dealership. And what we had collected at that time, I'm afraid, did not match the electric Tesla automobile that we were going to buy. So you're going to have to wait one more year. However, as a small appreciation from all the members and friends of Aldersgate, I'd like to present you with this cash gift. Thank you so much, Kyle. The other person is Rachel. Pastor Rachel. This young lady brings to us so much. I'm not going to turn into a John Boehner if I'm not careful here.
You're not tan enough.
What do I say for Rachel? Rachel brings us not only the dedication that so many other people bring to us, so many volunteers, including Kayo. She brings to us a certain strength. And it's not just in the messages that we hear every Sunday. The message we hear today is direct to the point. It's common, it's everybody understands it. And even the children can understand that message. It's very, very special to me. You offer us leadership, but at the same time, there's something else that you keep doing again. Trips to Maine, organizing all the fundraisers, it's just everything throughout the community, your presence here, just, it brings us all together. I don't know how to describe it, but thank you very much, Rachel. So,
Lesson 5, Matthew, chapter 2, 1, verses 1 through 2, 9 through 11. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem, in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born of the King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On the coming of the house, they saw a child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened his treasures and presented him the gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
Child is there so late to rest.
God has shared is from person to person, conversation after conversation, the way the candle flame is passed around the room. All of us have heard the good news of Jesus coming. All of us have experienced the love of God. It's up to us to share that with someone out into the world. And so as we join in singing Silent Night, and as we join in passing a candle's flame around the room, remember that this symbolizes your action out in the world beyond this place, that you would share the light and the love of God with another. I invite you to stand up and make a circle around the perimeter of the room.
What they have done has been done in the sight of God. such good news. This is such a wonderful joy. We need to go share it. And so, although we extinguish our candles, our message is not extinguished as we go from here. I would like to invite the children forward to tell us what we are to do next.
Catch your eye.